week. Thank you for tuning into today's show. We're going to go ahead and go over the secondary. But before we do that, I'd like to remind everybody to make sure you go to twitch.tv/NinerFaithfulRadio to join us for all our live streams for the Faithful by the Faithful. Pre-launch sale is coming July 30th. Go to NinerFaithfulRadio.com/shop for more details. Make sure you go to SeatGiant.com. Use the promo code NinerFaithfulRadio to save on all your theater, concert, and sporting event tickets. Go to NinerFaithfulRadio.com to check out all our previous episodes of all our shows and our blogs and a couple goodies we're working on for you there. Make sure you click on our affiliate link if you go to Shop49ers.com. Shop49ers.com. It costs you no more, and it really helps out the show. Follow us on social media, on Facebook and Instagram is at Niner Faithful Radio. And on Twitter, it's at Niner Faithful R. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, faithful of all ages, let's get the show started. Montana steps up, throws. All right, we're getting started. Let's get it cracking. Let's bring on the man with the master plan. What's cracking, Jason? How you doing, bro?
What is up, man? It's another day living the dream, trying to survive up here.
Hey, you know, like I tell everybody, anytime you wake up a five-time champion, it's a good day. But unless it's the day after Super Bowl 54, but we won't get into that. Or Super Bowl 47. Anyway, Jason, why don't you go ahead, and I know we were talking about it, and I said I would let you, there's no supplemental draft?
Yeah, I just got announced, I think, want to say about 3 hours ago that the NFL is not doing a supplemental draft this year. I don't even know if anybody actually declared for it. Basically, it's for anybody who, at the deadline to declare for the NFL draft, you know, something happens, you get kicked out of school, anything in general, go to supplemental draft. This year and last year, because of COVID, basically they canceled it. But to be honest, most years, maybe one, if that, two players get drafted out of it. So it's not a big thing. Every once in a while you get someone like a Terrell Pryor or Josh Gordon and stuff like that. But for the most part, not much comes out of it. But another year without it, I don't need it. I understand why they have it, but I don't think they actually need it.
Well, I think, let's be real, why does the NFL have the supplemental draft? Because they're going to get any opportunity to, A, find a diamond in the rough, and, B, to get cheaper talent. You know, that's really what the NFL is about getting you in, and then the second you get in, to find somebody who does your job just as good, if not better, for cheaper. That's basically essentially your job. You stay on a team until somebody can come in to do their job, the equivalent of you, that's cheaper. That's essentially what the NFL is. It's a race to find somebody to replace you.
Yeah, but they could do the same things where, like, you're like, hey, it's the middle of June, I think.
Yeah.
You know, and then you just basically take the standings from last year and you go bottom to top, almost like, you know, like a fantasy football league where whoever is the worst in the league gets first in there. You just as easily do that.
Yeah, you know, and my thing about it is look, at the end of the day, I like to – sometimes in football we lose the human element of it, you know, because when you're a fan of a team and not players per se, it's like – I mean, yeah, the players matter, but it's like, bro, like, I mean, I'm going to be, like, literally, as long as I'm alive, I'm going to be a Niner fan after every single player that's on the team right now is no longer on the team. You know, like, I'm still going to be a fan. So you kind of lose that. But at the end of the day, you know, it's an opportunity for somebody to live their dream. And you know what? If I was good enough football player that I could be taken, maybe not in the draft or undrafted, but maybe could have possibly gotten a look at a supplemental draft, would I want that opportunity to say, hey, look, this is the very last opportunity for me to live my dream, you know, that I've been working on my whole life, you know, and at least, you know, shoot my shot. You know, and say, hey, let me get into a camp, and if I can't cut it, I can't cut it. Yeah, so, I mean, it sucks, you know, from that aspect, but, I mean, I don't think that I don't think the Niners are missing out on any Hall of Famers.
Somebody's just going to get the rosters, let alone, you know.
Yeah, exactly. So, we're going to go ahead and start off with the cornerbacks here and everything like that. And the first one on our list is Mark Field. He's going into his second year out of Clemson. Where did he come from? Let me see. He originally was entered the NFL after being signed by the Kansas City Chiefs as an undrafted free agent May 6, 2019. After spending time in their training camp, he was traded to Minnesota on August 31st, 2019. Appeared in Minnesota's first game of the season prior to being waived on the 14th. Fields was later signed to the Vikings practice squad on the 16th of September, where he spent the remainder of the season. My straight up opinion about this is it sounds like they're trying to. I don't think we want to invest serious capital in the secondary. I don't think we're going to be investing. We don't have any first round picks for a while, and I don't think we're going to be investing second. I was honestly surprised we took some in the third after not taking any in the second. But to me, it's somebody that. Okay, we're going to give him a look. You never know. I mean, did anybody think that Emmanuel Mosley was going to be a starter when he signed as an undrafted free agent? No. You know, did anybody think Raheem Mostert was going to be – you know, you were talking about how the running back, you know, game took a hit and how, you know, Raheem was missed when Raheem Mostert signed as an undrafted free agent? No. So he has an opportunity, but I don't think it's somebody that's going to make the roster. Jason, your thoughts?
Not going to make the roster. This roster is loaded with too much young talent, and probably young talent, good talent, is actually going to play this year because of how some of the players are going to be. So I practice squad slash just fodder.
Yeah. Look, if Mark Fields is beating out D'Amador Lenore or Avery Thomas, it's cool, awesome. Great for Mark Fields, but that means we have some serious problems about our scouting and drafting process. If our third round pick is getting beat out by, we need to get Tim Harris Jr. is the next one. He's going into his second year after coming in. Oh yeah, wait, no. Sorry, yeah, it was 2019. We were picked. I apologize. He was injured all 2019, got into two games last year, literally has no stats. I believe they were special team stats. He was originally that's Fields. He was originally selected, it'll say right here. Wow, it didn't even say when he was drafted. You know click here for full bio. You know, the Niners website, we were talking about earlier. Okay, yeah, so it's the second year, acquired sixth round in 2019. So 1920. This will be his third year. You know, we were talking about this, and if anybody of the Niners watches the show, y'all need to step your website game up.
Because your depth chart. This is 12.
Yeah, because
come on, man.
Well, the depth chart is done by the PR staff, but I will, if you want to hire, dude, you don't even really got to pay me. You can pay me minimum wage and just make sure I go to every Niner game, and I'll come run your way. I literally will make my sole purpose in my life to make sure your website is up to date as possible. I will make that my sole purpose in life.
Just let me in the building.
Seriously. Just let me see the real trophies. That's all I want. Just let me see the real trophies. But, yeah, so, sixth-round pick in 2019, took a flyer. Honestly, I don't see him sticking around, not with Avery Thomas and D'Amador Lenore just drafted in the third and fifth round, respectively. I'm good. Yet again, it sucks. You know, hate that we were, again, talking in our pre-show meeting about injuries. And here's something that you could really say. Maybe injuries did take a factor of this young man's career and never really got, you know, too much of an opportunity to get on the field because of them. But hey, it's a what have you done for me lately league. And sorry, kid, there's a third round pick and a fifth round pick now at your position. So, hey, cool. Give him the opportunity. Let him battle it out in camp. You know, you give him your opportunity and say, hey, go earn your spot. But my money ain't on him. Jason?
He's the Jalen Hurd of the defense. I mean, when you think about it, he's a lot of talent. You know, there's some talent that you saw there, and it just hasn't taken off because of one thing or another with injuries. So, the only thing I can think of is, like I said, he reminds me he's the defensive version of Jalen Hurd. Like, it looks good on paper.
Yeah.
It just hasn't materialized yet.
Without the height.
Yeah, not as much
height. Without the height.
But, you know, he said talent-wise, I was interested in him when he showed up.
Yeah.
He looked good and picked the part.
Yeah, the highlight tape was good.
Jalen Hurd. Yeah, the highlight was good. You know, the size and everything is there. Just,
And you have to look understand where were we at 2019. You had Richard Sherman probably going in, you know, what ended up being his you know, best season as a Niner, but you know, you weren't going to know it in 2019. But you had Richard Sherman, who you knew that you were going to have for 19 and 20 at least, you know. And so it's okay, hey, we like this corner who, you know, has the size and everything like that. Let Richard Sherman mold him. And we'll see where we're at coming 2021. Injuries derailed that, but here we are 2021. So let's see what we got, kid. Now, we're going on to Mr. Never Say Die. That's Mr. Dante Johnson, 8 years. Okay, so let me – I believe this is like his fourth extent on the team.
He's been off and on the team a few times.
Let me see. I'm trying to pull up his career right now. It's taking forever to load. But 8 years, you know. Okay, so Arizona was the only other team, and he literally only appeared in one game. So he's only other. He was drafted in 2014 and only literally appeared in one other game for another franchise. So he has 87 career games. You know. I think that a lot of people get on Dante Johnson, and Dante Johnson to me, who I've actually bumped into a couple times, nice guy. Dante Johnson to me reminds me a little bit of something Kyle Shanahan said last year, where it says like, hey, you know what? You know why people love Elvis Gerback or Steve Bono as Niner backups? You know why they're held in such Niner lore? A, because they're good quarterbacks, but B, because they really didn't have to play that much. You know, they really didn't. And so, but they're clearly backups for a reason. And so what I think that you saw last year, is that, you know, if Nick Mullins went and played for the Giants, the Jets and Giants game, finished out the Jets game, played the Giants game and everything, and let's say that he doesn't play in the Philly game, right? Or even fine, plays in the Philly game, and then Jimmy comes back Miami and stays on the field the rest of the year. Nick Mullins is probably still on this team. But because what happened is Nick Mullins got exposed as a backup, you know, really third stringer, you know, backup, you know, third string to backup quarterback because he had to play long enough. And I think that's what happens to Dante Johnson. You know, if you're bringing in Dante Johnson in a couple plays, you know, maybe even a game or two, I think you could do – have Brian Allen, you know, as your quarterback. So if you would tell me, hey, knock on wood, you know, something happens and we need a cornerback to start a game, I mean, you know, you could do worse than Dante Johnson, who you know, hey, he's experienced. Like I said, this is going to be his ninth season. So, you know, came in the same year, same draft as Jimmy Ward. So you're saying, hey, you know, he has that 8 years of experience. You know what you're going to get from him. And I'll tell you, coaches will always say, I want the backup that I know what I'm going to get from. They want players in general, but especially backups. If I can scheme and I can do things as long as I know what I'm going to get from you. You know what I'm saying? We can hide your deficiencies. We can do whatever. But as long as we know what we're going to get from you, we can work with that. And I think that's what Dante Johnson is. And so the ultimate question we'll answer later and everything like that. But I think Dante Johnson makes a roster. You know, we're not going to give away all our roster, but, you know, I don't even remember how many we kept last year, but I'll go ahead and look that up when we get towards the end, when we run our probably run a commercial break or something. But look, he's not a superstar. Fine. If he's starting you a game or a series of games, yeah, okay, you might be a little bit in trouble. But I think if Dante Johnson does what he is, and that's a backup, and he plays sparingly like a backup should to either rest the starter or, you know, whatever happens, then, yeah, I want Dante Johnson on my team. I don't want him on my, you know, starting a game, ideally. But, you know, if it's coming in for a play or two, you know, because let's be real, E-Man, you know, didn't have the world's greatest season last year, you know, and you know, special teams, that type of nature, yeah, I'm down for that. Moving on for Dante Johnson, Emmanuel Mosley, speaking of the devil, going into his fourth year, the undrafted free agent in 2018, sorry. I had to do a little math right there. Obviously going to make the team. He's obviously going to be our starter. And I think that what happened last year is look, I don't think Emmanuel Mosley is as bad as some points that he played last year. I think that he's not even as bad as he was in the Super Bowl, which, by the way, you know, per the rules of Cover 3, which is what they were in, Emmanuel Mosley played the coverage right. Really what it is they had installed it for they prepared for that WASP concept, and Jimmy Ward played it the way he did because he expected Emmanuel Mosley to be in a different place. And so I don't necessarily blame that, because really what he did is he didn't expect Patrick Mahomes to make a freaky throw like he did. That's just a throw that normal humans can't make. Yeah, and so you're sitting there, you're saying, hey, I'm playing the odds that he's not making that throw, and so I'm going to do – and you got burned on that. Fine, you know, he makes a pick six. Nobody ever blames him, you know. So, you know, I think that, look, I don't think Emmanuel Mosley is a long-term solution. You know, I do think we're going to have to get some corners in here, whether it's free agency, whether it's the draft. You know, fine, we can do worse than Emmanuel Mosley, but I think that we need to get – he's not – or I should say this. He's always going to be your second-best corner. And so if your plan is, you know, there might be some reasons, and we'll get into it a little bit, to not sign Jason Verrett, you know, I'm not against it, but whatever. You know, fine, if you got Jason Verrett and Emmanuel Mosley, okay, cool. You know, fine, I think that could be a Super Bowl caliber, you know, starting corners. But if you're having, you know, Emmanuel Mosley with question mark, then I got some concerns. You know, then I'm a little bit of a, okay, well, what are we doing here? Jason, your thoughts on E-Man?
I do believe that he's probably a better slot cornerback than an actual outside cornerback.
Yeah.
PFF has him ranked at the low 70s, 72, 3, something like that. So, I mean, according to them, there's actually other secondaries. Almost, you can almost push that third. Somebody's third cornerback is better than Mosley, which I don't think
he's that,
to be honest. I really don't. Like I said, a little bit out of position, maybe, but I think he benefits. His stock went down because he's not used to playing outside, but I thought he did a decent job for playing it. When you're mostly a slot cornerback, yeah, all of a sudden, like, you're going out against other, you know, outside. But as far as him,
well, let me ask you this.
Okay.
Let me ask you this question before we go a little bit further. Do the Niners make it to the Super Bowl in 2019 without Emmanuel Mosley, with playing a Keller Witherspoon?
No.
No. Do they even beat the Vikings?
No.
I don't even think they beat the Vikings. Well, that game's a lot closer. That game's a lot closer.
Yeah, he's kind of forced and, into that one because of how bad Achilles – he was like a broken mental at that point.
So I think that's where it's at, Emmanuel Mosley. I think Emmanuel Mosley might be the Daniel Brunskill of the secondary. And what I mean by that is that, he could be your starter, but is the team better with him being your first play off the bench? Yes, and I think that's where I'm at with Emmanuel Mosley. Good player, good enough to be a starter. But you know what? I'm looking forward, and I think that's what I was trying to get to a few moments ago, was I'm looking forward to the day where it's like, hey, look, we're good enough in our secondary that Emmanuel Mosley, who could be a starter, is now our first player off the bench. You know, and like we are with the O-line, which is, hey, Daniel Brunskill, and we'll talk about the guard battle. That's actually low-key one of my actually underrated, one of my favorite position battles that we're going on. But Daniel Brunskill is good enough to be a starter at guard, but now we're at the point where it's like, hey, we think this Aaron Banks kid's going to be better, so our offensive line is better because now Daniel Brunskill comes off the bench. I think that's a better of Emmanuel Mosley. Let's just say, for example, I'm not saying we're going to re-sign him or trade for him or whatever, but if Gilmore, you know, and Verrett are your starters, and Emmanuel Mosley's coming off the bench, either to back up K1 or find, you know, to one of the outside spots, then, yeah, I really honestly think that's the best version of the Niners secondary that we can have. Would you agree with that, Brett?
Yeah. The question is, who picks up the slack would be the only question. I would love it if, say, next year either Lenore or Ambry step up and they prove that they are the better starting quarterback. And then that lets if that were to happen, that means your two quarterbacks coming off the bench is going to be Mosley and then Williams. I'm okay with those four.
Yeah, me too. All right, speaking of the devil, to me, I think that if you were to ask me, besides the big one, what's your most non-talked about kind of low-key to this season is the health of this man right here, Mr. Jason Verrett. Played in, I want to say it was 14 games 14, last year. Let's go ahead. Yeah, 14, I believe. Wow, it's not even giving me a chance to look at how many games he played in last year. Wow, that's horrible. So, to me, Jason Verrett's one of the most underrated keys to the season, because if Jason Verrett gives a performance like he did last season, which I believe he will if he can stay healthy, not that way, then I legitimately believe we're a Super Bowl team. I believe if you go back and watch Red and Gold Rewind, I went back and I looked at that 2011 Ains game, you know, the playoff game in 2011, the Vernon Post, the grabs. Two, the catch three, whatever you want to call it. And to me, I thought that how good that defense was. Like, that might have been one of the best non-championship defenses we have had in team history. And I was literally thinking about how we had Pro Bowlers on every level of our defense. And I think that Jason Verrett, if he can play at what he did last year, and everything like that, I very well think that we could have that same type of thing. I mean, what you would assume Bosa would make a Pro Bowl, I would think. You know, Bosa, maybe Kinlaw, Armstead, you know, maybe as a little like kind of sneaky, you know, ones. Obviously, you're expecting Bam Bam. You're obviously expecting Bam Bam to make the Pro Bowl. And then, you know, maybe Jimmy Ward. I think that Jimmy Ward might be a little candidate to have a little, and we'll talk about him in a few players. But so I mean, and then you know, Jason Verrett, that's a pretty freaking solid defense. And so I think that Jason Verrett's one of the keys to the season, because if he can be healthy and perform at that level, and then you know you're having Nick Bosa coming back, Bam Bam's obviously you're assuming only going to get better. You know, Jaquaski Tartt and Jimmy Ward, I think, are, look, if we don't fix, if we don't have a plan after Jimmy Ward and Jaquaski Tartt leave, I think you're really going to notice, and Niner fans are really going to learn that they should have appreciated what we have with Jaquaski Tartt and Jimmy Ward, you know, in the secondary. So I believe that Jason Verrett is somebody to me this year is about, hey, Jason, are you a 2-3 year solution to corner, or are we trying to, you know, pray that you make it through the season and trying to get you through the season? If he's an all pro corner, then it's not going to be about whether we want him. It's going to be about can we afford him. If he has an injury season, then, you know, we're in trouble. Because then you might be talking about, you know, rookies or Dante Johnson or something starting some games for you. And, Jason, your thoughts on Jason Verrett? Jason, your thoughts on Jason?
Jason to Jason, yeah.
Jason to Jason. Jason to Jason Love.
He's probably a top five corner, I think, if he stays healthy. And all intentions are he's finally back to being what he was prior to when he signed with the Niners. You know, everything looks good. You know, he's had some of the best seasons that he's had in the last couple of years. And so, you know, let's hope that, you know, because obviously we're losing a bunch with no one knows quite what's going on with Sherman. So if we just take him out of the season, I really don't know.
We'll get into that later.
That's later. But if someone has to take over that Sherman role of going after, you know, covering the number one, it has to be Verrett. For some reason, I always want to call him Vernet, but I know there's not an N in there for some reason. Verrett. Yeah. But I don't know why. Talent wise, everything else, he's one of the best in the league. Like, look at some of the people that he covered last year. Like, he was covering Metcalf, and Metcalf is a monster. They couldn't do anything. They couldn't get anything in Metcalf on either game.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you take your biggest guy as a receiver, he will shut them down.
Yeah, I think that the play that sold me was the pick in the Yams game.
Yeah.
That to me, because that to me was I think what you happen with a lot of corners, and this is why you see players like Sherm, I think why he's so special, is because a lot of corners are the best athletes on the field. You know, and I think what a lot of corners happens, and you always say that you see a significant drop off from corners, is because I think a lot of corners are used to being the best athletes, and so they dominate by their you know, speed, their agility, you know, their quickness, things like that nature. And then once that starts to derail, well, now you've lost everything that's made you a good corner. What impressed me about the pick of the Yams was that Jason Verrett still had the physical skills, but that was a mental play. That was a preparation. That was a film study play. And that's why I think separates Sherman, and why you saw post-Achilles how Richard Sherman was still able to have a productive, you know, to really 2018 was in, but he was able to, you know, have a productive 2019. Why? Because that's saw the mental game. That's why Sherman still had a chance to have a career. That's why Jason Verrett, I think, still has a chance to come to a career, because now that the physical skills might start to deteriorate, well, now you still have that mental preparation. That's what impressed me so much about that Yams pick, not only because it was a big play in the game and possibly one of the low-key reasons we won the game. I'm talking about the one at Levi's. But also because of that, wow, okay, that's special. Because if you can put great, you know, physical tools, which he has, together with that mental preparation, even as later in the season when clearly he wasn't playing, you know, probably feeling the best, you know, nobody's feeling the best. And you and I have talked about several times on the show about how if we don't get that bye week, I don't think we're going to make the Super Bowl, because that's a 12-week stretch just to get out of the regular season. That's going to be very hard on Jason Verrett. You know, let's be real. It's going to be hard on Jason Verrett on A1 Williams, who we'll get to later on as well. I think that the mental side will help him get together. Next, we got Ken Webster going into his fourth season. He was originally brought in 2019. I mean, I'm not going to really spend a lot of time on Ken Webster. Jason, your thoughts? I'm thinking camp body. Maybe bottom tier of the roster.
He's not making a roster. Well, he's not going to make, you know, some stuff, so.
Yeah.
He's going to be practice squad.
Practice squad. All right, now we're starting to get into the ones that I think that will really bring us some. Okay, Kiana Nuka. I don't even know, but apparently he's entering his third year. He was originally signed by Cleveland in 2017. You know what? I think I'm making a new rule on Niner Faithful Radio. If I've never heard of you, I think you're not making the roster. Because I would like to say I'm pretty up to date on players that have a good chance to make the roster here.
I've seen his name and stuff listed, but I'm just like, who? I never, you know, so.
Okay. So that's the last little bit of the players that we're going to get into. Now, on to K'Juan Williams, who to me, I think that he was the ultimate one-year player. Because I don't think I want – K'Juan's getting on the wrong side of 30 after this season. And so did I want the Niners to bring back K'Juan Williams? Hell yeah. I honestly thought he was going to the Jets. I thought there's two players that I expected to be gone to the Jets that Robert Saleh has a total football woody for is K'Juan Williams and Ronnie Blair. You know, is Super Blair. And so I thought they were gone. I thought K'Juan was going to be – and so when he didn't sign, especially after Sherm had made that tweet about, well, you know, K'Juan is from New Jersey, I was like, oh, yeah, K'Juan's gone. I thought K'Juan was gone. And then when he came back on the one-year deal, I was like, this is perfect. Because I didn't want to invest 2, 3, 4 years into K'Juan, who, you know, legendary at his job, probably one of the best nickel corners in his job. And, you know, we talk about Jimmy, we talk about, you know, but I think when we talk about injuries with this team, it seems like certain players we don't mention it as much with, and K1's one of them. I mean, let's not pretend that K1 hasn't missed the time. And so, to me, he. This is what I want from K1. K1 is, hey, you know what? We're going to try to get you through this year. Expect you to play at the Pro Bowl level. But I think there's a reason that we drafted D'Amador Lenore. I think that, obviously, we're going to try him at outside corner because that's where we need him the most right now. But I believe he's K1's backup. You know. Dante Johnson played a little bit of slot last year, but clearly the team has, you know, I'm thinking D'Amador and Lenore in their plans for future at slot corner. So love it. Love that we brought K1 back for another year. Love the Shark. Makes legendary plays, but I'm not looking at him beyond this year. Jason, your thoughts?
Pretty much the same thing. He's back here just to get as a bridge. So the next year, maybe two at the most, depending on the development of Ambry and Lenore. But for the most part, yeah, like you said, I'm glad he's back. Because even with some of the issues that he's had as far as injuries and stuff like that, you still need someone who knows the defense that can help. You know, if he's going to play that, you know, Sherman role where he's just kind of like a coach and a mentor to the younger guys growing up, I'm good with that. I don't mind it. But yeah, last year, the number one ranked slot corner in the league. So, I mean, when he's older, he can still be a damn good corner.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
We're getting younger, and he's probably going to be one of the first people to go next year, you know, if the two young guys start picking up.
One, I believe I read a stat this year that said we're the second oldest team. That's changing. I think that clearly they want, after this year, we're clearly going to, the youth movement is coming. And so, love K1. Tip my cap to him. I'll wish him best luck in free agency and everything like that. But I ultimately think in an ideal world, the Niners would say, hey, we'd love for you to play until Lenore's ready. And that, you know, at some point this season, if Lenore, you know, is the better option at slot corner or K1 gets hurt or whatever, I think that's what they're praying. They're basically praying that K1 can last until Lenore's ready. If he lasts a full season, they're doing backflips. But please, at least last until Lenore's ready, because I don't think he's, you know, day one starter, step in and ready to play nickel in the NFL. I'm sorry. You know, you're not ready to go against Cooper Kupp. You know, hey, Rook, go against Cooper Kupp. Yeah, I know. We're going to put number 24 there. So speaking of the devil, we are on to our Mr. Lenore. Was a fifth-round selection out of the University of Oregon, where he played in 47 games in 4 years. Recorded 154 tackles, 27 pass defense, 6 picks, 4 tackles for loss, 2 forced fumbles, and 1 recovered fumble. A little bit, let me see. Oh, wow, they didn't mention this in his little notes. But the cool thing about Lenore is he has I believe it's across his chest, has a tattoo of his brother. And his brother was actually a diehard Niner fan. And so I remember after he had shared that in he had shared that in a press conference, I went and tweeted him out there and I said, he's on the field with you, bro. Take him with you. You know, I was like, you know, save him a seat at Levi's. Know that he would have been there with whatever Niner hat he wore. Or I don't know if he wore hats, but he definitely would have been there rocking your jersey. You know, obviously because it's his team. And then now his brother, you know, I would assume he'd obviously be at the game rocking his, you know, your brother's on the team, your favorite team. You're rocking his jersey and you're coming to the games. So, you know, and everything. And we talk about here on Niner Faithful Radio all the time about, you know, the mental aspect of the game. And motivation, how some players have all the talent in the world but don't cut it because they don't have the motivation. And how some players aren't really that talented, but they make great careers. Why? Because they have the motivation for it. And so that's something that, look, I'm not going to make an announcement. I'd like to do a little bit more studying and everything before I make my official rookie to watch. But I would definitely say the Hyena is in contention for my rookie to watch. I think that – if it wasn't for Sherman, Sherman's probably going to be it because I think he'll have the most impact, you know, because obviously we discussed it when we talked about our running backs. I think he'll lead the team in carries. So that's obviously going to, you know, your rookie to watch is obviously going to be the one you think that's going to lead the team in carries. But Lenore, I have a feeling we're going to, if maybe not this year, but we're going to hear some things from Lenore. Jason, your thoughts?
Yeah, him. It's between him and Thomas. They're both being groomed to eventually take over starting positions long term. You know, like you said, Jason Vernette, you know, he's getting close to being up in age. Mosley, you can argue, is probably, you know, better suited for the slot overall. So, you know, he's definitely, especially, you know, like I said, this is, you know, his uncle's brother, whatever it is, you know, he's sure, you know, they're grooming him for a bigger role in the future. So he's going to be there. Obviously, he makes my roster that I have.
That is so crazy. They don't – no, I fully agree with you there. They literally don't have Avery Thomas on the roster right now. Maybe it's because he's not signed. That might be where it is. Oh, wait, here we go. Unsigned draft pick. Yeah, they have him right here listed under undrafted, unsigned draft pick.
Okay.
I was like, wow. That's
give somebody else the job.
No, I think they have to list him because he's officially not on the roster because he's unsigned. I think that's what that is. But, yeah, no, I fully agree. He's going to make the roster. I mean, I would think that yet again, we have some serious problems if he doesn't make the roster, you know. But we got some significant problems if he doesn't make the roster. But I think he is. And he's one of my rookies to watch. And, you know.
Yeah.
Probably potential starter. Okay. Now on to low-key, one of my favorite. You know, I've given him a hard time over the years, but the longest tenured Niner and one of my favorite, honestly, in 2019, the Niner I actually was most proud of is Jimmy Ward. And, you know, I think that look, we all know Jimmy Ward's past. The injury concerns are legit. Like, we cannot deny that. He cannot deny that. You know, that's something that happened. But the talent has never been the issue. That's clearly – it was – you know, I think it's funny because he gets a lot of shit, deservedly so. But, you know, Trent Baalke did hit on some picks. You know, our starting secondary, you know, they weren't bad – Jaquaski Tartt and Jimmy Ward weren't bad picks. You know, yeah, would you have liked them to not be injured as much? Yes, of course. could you go back and in hindsight probably get some players that played more games to play just as a level, if not better? Yeah, okay, fine. They don't get turnovers. Well, I think that's more scheme oriented, you know, with Jimmy Ward and everything like that. And I think it has to do with more of the fact that he's so freaking good they don't throw at him. I mean, to me, I'll point out to two games where I literally saw Jimmy Ward. It was the first game against the Whackers. And to me, where I think one of the most underrated plays of the playoffs is this hit on just Stephon Diggs. When the ball was completed and he came and he rocked it and it was incomplete. And if that play doesn't happen, you know, and it's Jimmy Ward, it's just one of those players that he does his damn job. You know, we've seen him on the I want to say it was 2019 where he had those two pass breakups and everything, went on fourth down that I believe sealed the game. And so it's I think what you're going to start to see with now that he's played more, which I don't believe, except for the games in 2019, the first couple games, I don't believe he's missed a game since. And so what you're starting to see now, is, hey, you know what? If he's on the field, Jimmy Ward's damn good. And that's why I said he might be a little low-key Pro Bowl rate, because you know what? Picks are fluky. You know what I'm saying? Turnovers are fluky. And so, you know what? If he gets a couple fluke picks this year where it's just like, all right, bro, I think it's been since like 2015 that you've had a pick, you're bound to get one, which I believe he's had a pick six called back, or at least a pick called back by a penalty. So, you know, let's just say he, by being in more of an aggressive playmaking type of role this year, since, you know, we all know that D'Amico Ryans is apparently going to play him more aggressive, he gets a couple fluke picks. I think that might be the difference between Jimmy Ward being an underrated safety into a Pro Bowler. Is, let's say he flukily gets five picks this year. Three fumble recoveries and five picks and forces six fumbles. Yeah. You know, just a crazy number like that. Just some fluky, probably never going to happen career year again, and he gets a couple fluky ones. I think that's honestly, the difference between him being, you know, underrated safety, you know, a Pro Bowler. Jason, your thoughts on the longest tenured Niner, Mr. Jimmy Ward?
Stay healthy. That's the biggest issue I have with Jimmy, both of them, on the offense and the defense. stay healthy. When he's on the field, he makes plays. The defense is a lot more aggressive in general with him on the field. He just has to stay healthy. You know, I think he's ranked number 15, and I think that's fine with him because he'd probably be top 10 if he was healthy and could actually stay in a little bit longer.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that Jimmy Ward stays healthy. I think that's another one where it's like, please, Jimmy Ward, stay healthy. It feels scary to say that, although, you know, like I just said, the last couple of years it hasn't, but it still feels scary, you know, to say that, because obviously I would feel a lot better if, you know, Tre'Davious Moore didn't rupture his Achilles. I'd have been like, all right, well, at least we got Tre'Davious Moore and fine. I understand that's not the greatest, but still, like, okay, cool. I have no idea who the hell we're bringing in. I mean, like, we'll get to some players that we can bring in here in a second, but, like, I mean, that becomes a concern. At least I've seen Tre'Davious Moore make plays in the NFL. You know, we've seen him, you know, have a pick in the Super Bowl and done some things where you're like, hey, this guy's got talent. Some of these safeties, it's a little after Jimmy Ward now. So, yeah, please stay healthy, Jimmy. Going on to another safety that really honestly has low-key always been one of my favorite Niners. I've met him before. Jaquaski Tart. You know, to me, I think about two plays when I think about Jaquaski Tart. I think about the pick against the Panthers, Kyle Shanahan's first game. And I think about where he basically punked DK Metcalf for the ball Veterans Day of 2019. He basically punked DK for that ball. Let's be real. He punked him for that ball. That was touchdown. And he snatched the ball from his head. It was a touchdown. It should have been a touchdown, and he basically said no. and took that ball from him. So that's mine. As Eric Davis said, he took that little brown baby. Eric Davis always calls the football the little brown baby. So he's like, we protect the little brown baby. And DK did not protect his little brown baby on that play. He got punked. So I think that Jaquaski Tart is just like Jimmy Ward. I don't think it's a question of the talent. The defense significantly, you know, it's not talked about how towards the end of 2019, the injuries on the defense started to add up. And I think the number one player we missed while he was out during the regular season in 2019 was Jaquaski Tart. Because you saw significantly that our secondary play went down significantly after Jaquaski Tart left. And yeah, you know, he played through it and played through his injury in the Super Bowl, but he wasn't 100%. And you could see that. And so, you know, Jaquaski Tart, yet another example. Please, for the love of God, stay healthy. Jason, your thoughts about Jaquaski?
Coming up Millhouse, the first statement is, for the love of God, just stay healthy this year. And the same thing, we can pretty much copy and paste for all the starters in the secondary next year. Stay healthy, win healthy, arguably a Pro Bowl level player. So if we can just keep these guys healthy, the secondary is going to be good. So like I said, it's the same thing with all of them, which is another one of the reasons why I think we've gone heavy towards drafting younger people the last couple of years, is because with these guys getting a little older, there's a little more punishment on their bodies. We're ready to start replacing some of these guys.
Yeah, no, I agree. I agree with you, 49er media. Yeah, no, Jimmy Ward. Yeah, sorry, I was just catching up on the comment. Yeah, no, I agree with you. So moving on, Marcel Harris. Now, this to me is a player that, look, I was fired up. He went to Florida. I'm a Gators fan. Gator bait. I've always wanted him to come in and make a play and just do the Gator bait for me. I actually brought my Florida shirt, and I wanted him to sign it. I actually want to get all Niners to sign my Florida shirt, all Niners that all Gators that have became Niners. But so Marcel Harris to me is, look, really honestly, to Talanoa Hufanga there, I've been practicing. I knew I was going to get it right. I think to me he takes his job. I think that's why we drafted Hufanga, was basically to basically take Marcel Harris's job. You never know. Obviously, if you back a rat into the corner, it's going to crawl through, you know, chew through you to get away. So maybe that gives Marcel fired up, and, you know, he comes out and has a training camp of his life and everything like that. But, yeah, I don't – honestly, I'm sad to say this, Marcel. I wish you the best of luck, but I think Hufanga is going to come, you know, take that job, especially with him. It's his contract's expiring after this year, too. Yeah, Hufanga is – I'm sorry. They're just going to keep Hufanga because he's going to be younger and cheaper. Jason, your thoughts?
I actually – like you said, I don't actually see Harris making the roster. It's going to be Hufanga that ends up being the backup.
Yeah.
Cheaper, you know. He's going to move around with cap numbers and stuff like that. So I don't see him actually, you know, getting on the field. It's going to be another one of those. If there's injuries and he's on the field starting, what the hell's going on?
Yeah, pretty much. Developmental piece, I think ideally I could see the only way that Marcel Harris makes a roster, like I said, has the camp of his life. Hufanga ain't ready. And they're like, okay, you're – not even enough, ready enough for us to put you on the roster and just make you the backup to the backup. Like, we need to put you on practice squad because you can't even be, you know, which could be a case. But honestly, I think in an ideal world, Hufanga makes this roster. Last couple of players, Tony Jefferson was signed basically the day that Javarius Moore ruptured his Achilles. Now, this was not – I want to make this clear, not signed to replace Javarius Moore. This move was coming. It just so happened to be a coincidence that it happened to be the main Javarius Moore. Yeah. Honestly, do I think they thought maybe a little something was on with Javarius? I think so. You know what I'm saying? I don't think that they knew he was going to rupture his Achilles, obviously, and they would have kept him off the field. But I think that they maybe sniffed that something wasn't right. And so I think he's going to make the roster just simply because who else? I mean, I hate to say it like that, but Jason, your thoughts?
I think he's going to make it simply because he's there and we need a body there, kind of a thing. Not horrible, but he's not, you know, he's definitely one of those guys that definitely should be on more practice squad than actually on a game day plan. But, yeah, I can see him making it just because he's familiar and he knows what's going on, so.
Okay, so last true players, Trayvon Wilson, 10-year pro, was originally drafted in 2012. I think he makes it, veteran backup, you know, free safety type. Jason, your thoughts?
Borderline, I think it's between him and maybe, like you said, maybe like a Harris kind of thing, depending on, you know, depending on how his camp goes. He's pretty relatively cheap if we were to cut him because of he gets outplayed at camp.
Yep. And then last two players, Jared Maiden. Why can't I say that name? Probably battle. Don't think he'll make it. I think they'll keep, you know, veterans over him. And then Ambry Thomas. I mean, look, if your third round pick isn't pushing somebody to be a starter, we got some serious issues. Cool. I'm not going to be mad if Emmanuel Moseley beats him out. That's what I'm going to expect. Look, you know, Emmanuel Moseley started in the Super Bowl. So let's not act like Emmanuel Moseley ain't some slouch and doesn't have some experience. You know what I'm saying? So I think that if Ambry Thomas comes out and wins the starting job, which I don't – I mean, they're going to say it's a competition, but I don't think it is, then cool. That means we made a great pick. Awesome. But I don't expect it to happen. You know, now next year, the year after, yeah, okay, we got some issues if he ain't pushing for a starting position. But, yeah, I would think that not this year, but he's going to make the roster. Jason, your thoughts?
Yeah, he's probably going to be pushing for a starting job. Maybe even, you know, depending on how the season goes. Maybe after, like everybody else playing the trade to Virginia. Maybe after the bye, he's ready to go. And so he takes over and puts Mosley back to the slot, you know, push everybody down one peg kind of thing. But he's definitely going to make it. He wasn't picked in the third round to, you know, to sit very long. So he'll definitely be there.
Yeah. You know, I'll put it to you this way. Now, I'm not saying that he's going to be at this level, but in the third round, we've selected Frank Gore, Joe Montana, and Fred Warner. Those are some pretty damn good players. So that's I'm not saying that level, but I mean you're expecting at least at the very least a starter. Yeah. Like a person that you're is a very solid starter. I'm not saying he's gonna be a superstar, but I'm expecting at least a solid starter. Okay, I think we pretty much have gone through who we're gonna make the roster. So I think we'll wrap up the episode with this and then we'll get ahead and get out of here. Jason. Elephant in the room. Let's talk about it. Are you bringing back Richard Sherman?
After camp only. See how it plays out. You know, say just freak injury or it's just they're not up to par at all, I'd bring Sherman back. But that would be the only way. I wouldn't bring him back right now and push everybody else down because you know he's going to start if he comes in. Especially like I said, I would wait and see what happens during camp. Let that play out. You know, help. Put somebody on the IR, like Sherman, you know, or put him on the IR and have him come back, you know, after the bye, just like everybody else is or something, you know. But if you want to get younger, which they seem to be doing at a bunch of positions, bringing Sherman back is ideal. But I'm not against bringing Sherman back. You still bring him back one of the best corners in the history of the league to help your team out. But if something else, you know, bring him back to help out T.J. Moore and Thomas. All you want for them. I'd be willing to give them some money just to do that. But as of right now,
yeah,
I wouldn't bring them back unless it's a camp kind of thing situation goes on.
Yeah, no, I'm not bringing Richard Sherman back. I'm fine if we have an injury. I'm looking in the trade market. I'm looking in the free agent market. I'm, you know, maybe making a trade or something, you know, seeing if there's a starter or, you know, whatever out here. you know, I'm not, I bring Richard Sherman back as a last resort. You know, I think that it's a situation where it's better to get rid of a player a year too early than a year too late. And I think honestly, last year was a year too late. You know, and look, I'm not blaming the team. You know, we were in the Super Bowl. Bring Richard Sherman back. Okay, cool. I wasn't necessarily against bringing him back last year. You know, fine. Were you going to eat the dead cap? Of course you're going to bring him back. You know. But, I'm not bringing Richard Sherman back. All right. We'll go ahead and we're going to go ahead and get up out of here. But before we go, Jason, tell the people how they can subscribe for free to our Twitch channel.
All right, so if you have an Amazon Prime account, you can link that with your Twitch account, and you get one free subscription to any of your favorite Twitch streamers. Hopefully that would be us. And basically, when you go to subscribe, just like you would for if you wanted to pay for a subscription, you just scroll down a little bit, there's a little box that says Subscriber Prime. Click that. It's free for you. It's money in the pocket for whomever you're subscribing it to. But yeah, like I said, definitely. Think about doing us. It definitely helps the stream. And at the same time, if you feel like just paying for it for just 3 years, please do that as well.
That would be awesome. All right. We'd like to remind everybody that For the Faithful by the Faithful pre-launch sale is coming July 30th. You can save 20% off of all designs. Go to ninerfaithfulradio.com/shop for more details. You can go to ninerfaithfulradio.com to check out all our previous episodes of all our blogs and all that good stuff. Make sure to use our affiliate link that will be in the description of the video and podcast. And make sure to follow us on social media on Instagram and Facebook at Niner Faithful Radio, at Twitter at Niner Faithful R. For Jamie, Jason, Nate, Jimmy, Dylan, Super Duper Moderator Kim, and myself, we'd like to thank you for tuning into this week's episode of Niner Faithful Radio. Jason, go ahead and run the ad and the raid. I'll be right back.
All right, here we go.
We're on commercial, right? Okay.
45 seconds.
All right. When we get back, let me know. I'll run the video and then we'll end it. And then I got to get something to eat, handle some shit, figure out whether I'm staying here another night or not.
Yeah.
So. But we've been making them. You'll see it, some of them have jumped, but it's 2 cents, 2 cents, 2 cents for ads. So yeah, so it's, hey, cool. You know what? To say that I made 2 cents off the show today,
yeah.
At least.
And we are back.
I'll take that. And we're back. All right, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for watching this week's show. We'll see you next week. Faith, love, and happiness. Go Niners.
Yeah.
Oh, this is dope. I like this one better than this one. Huh, I wonder, what's this one do? Oh, hey. Oh, we don't have three people. Anyway, all right. Oh, shit. Is that solo? I don't know what I just did. Okay. All right, y'all. Hold on. Wait, where are we at? I want to wait 21 seconds because I want to see if we can get exactly on the hour. So wait for it. Wait for it. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, see ya!